Charles Ross Duke Jr. He's an astronaut, a brigadier general, United States Air Force retired. But he was just like the rest of us, he was born. And I'm sure that his mom and dad were just as excited as they could be. He was born October 3rd, 1935. He attended Lancaster High School and graduated from the Admiral Farragut Academy in St. Petersburg, Florida in 1953 as valedictorian. He attended the U.S. Naval Academy, got his Bachelor of Science, then received a Master of Science in Aeronautics and Astronomics at MIT. He went to the United States Air Force Test Pilot School. He has received honorary PhDs from the University of South Carolina and Francis Marion College. Astronaut Duke is the son of Charles M. and Willie Walter Waters Duke of Lancaster. He's married to Dorothy Lee Claiborne. He has two sons with his wife and eight grandchildren. That's really training those kids well, isn't it? Nine now, so that's absolutely terrific. He loves hunting and fishing and reading and flying and chasing that little ball all around the golf course. He's a member of many different organizations, including the Society of Experimental Test Pilots, the Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship International, the Explorers Club, and several others. He has received numerous honors, including the Air Force Distinguished Service Medal with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Air Force Legion of Merit, and Distinguished Eagle Scout Award from the Boy Scouts of America. After he graduated from the Naval Academy and received his commission, he entered pilot training and received his wings in September 1958, served 3 years in Germany as a fighter interceptor pilot with the 526th Fighter Interceptor Squadron at Ramsden. He was then assigned to MIT for his master's degree. He entered the U.S. Air Force Test Pilot School at Edwards. He's logged 4,147 hours flying time, and that includes 3,632 hours in a jet aircraft. He's one of 19 astronauts selected by NASA in April 1966. He served as the lunar module pilot of Apollo 16 in 1972. On his fifth manned lunar mission, he was accompanied by John Young, who was the spacecraft commander, and Thomas Mattingly, who was the command module pilot. This was the aircraft that was the first scientific expedition to inspect, survey, and sample materials and surface features in the Descartes region of the moon. They accomplished a great deal. They logged something in the neighborhood for 20 hours and 15 minutes in extravehicular activities. That probably requires some definition there. It includes the emplacement and activation of scientific equipment and experiments, the collection of nearly 213 pounds of rock and soil samples. They were going to take more, but they would have had to leave somebody behind. So they couldn't do that. And the evaluation and the use of Rover 2 over the roughest and blockiest surface yet encountered on the moon. He has had a remarkable life, and having logged 265 hours in Apollo work in 51 minutes in space, in which include 21 hours and 28 minutes in extravehicular activities, and he served as backup on a number of other missions. He's presently the owner of Duke Investments, the president of Charlie Duke Enterprises. He's an active, motivational, and inspirational speaker, travels a great deal. He's got 40 years experience as an entrepreneur, a business executive, military officer, and astronaut. He's appeared on numerous venues, including television shows and hundreds of associations, clubs, organizations, churches, and schools all over the world. He and his wife reside in New Braunfels, is that the, Texas? They've co-authored a book, Moonwalker, released by Oliver Nelson Publishers in March 1990 and produced two videos, DVDs, Moonwalker and Walk on the Moon and Walk with the Sun. Those are available, incidentally, out at the little table just outside the door there, and you'll be able to go ahead and acquire those afterwards. He's a remarkable man, undertaking extraordinary events. He's a member of a very small club of people who walk where no other people have walked. Would you please welcome Rick Gannon?
It's a delight to be with you this morning and have an opportunity to share my life with you and this great tradition of prayer breakfasts that are held all over the United States, military bases and cities and communities such as yours. And it's a delight to see so many people loving God and honoring God in such an event. I want to talk about the place of faith in our culture and faith in our lives and share my life and some thoughts with you as a Christian. You might wonder, how did I get to be a general graduating from the Naval Academy? And, well, back in the 50s, when I graduated, there wasn't any Air Force Academy. And they allowed 25% of West Point and Annapolis to volunteer for the Air Force. And that's where the Air Force was getting their, what we call regular officers back in those days. And so I had my physical admiral up at Bancroft Hall at the medical clinic, and the doctor said to me, "Midshipman Duke, you got astigmatism in your right eye. You don't qualify for naval aviation, but the Air Force will take you." And I raised my hand and was sworn in as a second lieutenant. And fortunately, NASA had the same requirements as the Air Force, and we finally all got together on those requirements, and I qualified for everything these days. But back then, it was a very special to land on carriers and stuff. I think that you thought they had that perfect eyes. And so I ended up in the Air Force, and it was a great career for me. When I was a little kid, I did not go out in the backyard and say, "Mama, one day I'm going to land on the moon." Mama would have sent me to the psychiatric hospital. But there wasn't a space program. It just wasn't. You know, what does life bring us throughout the years as we plan and we set goals and work, and all of a sudden the doors open. And fortunately for me, I volunteered for everything I could. And it turned out to be a great career for me, my 29 years active in reserve in the military. This morning we recited the Pledge of Allegiance. And if I had a title for this talk, it would be printed in the program. It would be One Nation Under God. And several years ago when I started doing these kind of talks, the thought occurred to me, if the nation is under God, our president is under God, the executive branch is under God, our Congress is under God, our judiciary is under God, this state is under God, this community is under God, our military is under God, our schools are under God, and you and I are under God. I ask you a question. Are you really under God? I ask myself that question. Am I really under God? Did I submit my will to God? Do I seek God's counsel in my life? Do I try to live by my actions that would reflect a godly life? Now, nobody asked me those questions back in Apollo. But had they asked me those questions, and I'd been honest with my answer, the answer had been no. Excuse me. I honored God, believed in God, out there somewhere was God, attended a Christian church, but I wasn't living a godly life. I was preparing for a flight to the moon, and my focus was the moon. And like we say in military terminology, when you get your guns going, I was boresighted on the moon. And that's what, that was all I was thinking about. I did not volunteer for the space program for fame or fortune. Fame is fleeting in the astronaut program. Hardly anybody remembers anybody except for Neil Armstrong. He's a great friend and a great pilot. If I'd have picked the guy who was going to be first on the moon, it would have been Neil Armstrong. So NASA knew what they were doing. But nobody ever recognizes Charlie Duke. I don't get on an airplane and have somebody sit down next to me and say, I know you. You walked on the moon. And if I got on in my spacesuit, they might recognize me. But that thing is in the Smithsonian Museum, and it's not a very comfortable thing to wear around anyway. So fame is fleeting. And fortune, in spite of what National Enquirer said, we did not get $1 million for going to the moon. I was a lieutenant colonel. I got paid like every other lieutenant colonel. And most of my buddies who were lieutenant colonels and majors were over in Vietnam getting shot at and shot down or shooting down. And they were really earning their pay. Now, I was just on this great adventure. But I gotta admit, the trip to the moon was a little extra. Believe it or not, a trip to the moon is TDY. And in military terminology, that's temporary duty. And they pay you per diem when you go there. And we had some very strict auditors at NASA, and I fell out of travel bag. Literally fell out of travel bag. It was something like Moon Pacific, no, Kennedy Moon Pacific. 11 days, and it was $25 a day back then. And however, government quarters and meals were furnished, so they didn't go to that part. And I said, well, how about mileage? Maybe a bit of mileage. And they said, no, we furnished the transportation. So for that, I was gone 11 days, and believe it or not, NASA actually gave me a check for $13.75. Which I either cashed or it's in my records, my memorabilia somewhere. So I didn't go for fame or fortune. We went for the thrill of adventure and the desire to explore. Our liftoff occurred at Kennedy Space Center on a Sunday afternoon in April 1972. If all this thing held together for the next 4 days and didn't break, we're going to be the fifth landing on the moon. And it turned out we were the fifth landing on the moon. There were six total of all the NASA missions. There were seven scheduled to land. The only one that didn't make it was Apollo 13. But we got them back safely, which was a miracle of, looking back now, a miracle of God. I mean, they were in desperate shape. But we were able to recover them safely. I'd been backup crew on that flight. John and I trained for a couple of years for Apollo 16. We were ready to go. And we climbed in our spacecraft on the top of that Saturn. And if you've never seen a Saturn, they're big. And they're 363 feet tall. It's 33 feet in diameter and weighs 6.5 million pounds with all of the fuel on board. And we were at the very top of this thing in the command module. And then at the bottom were five engines pushing with 7.5 million pounds. So it moved very slowly off the launch pad, but it was shaking like crazy from side to side. I found out later from a flight surgeon, they told me it was going to shake, but I didn't think it was going to shake this bad. And the windows were covered over, so you couldn't see outside, so you're just looking at your instrument panel, and it's vibrating, and you're vibrating, and John's very laconically said, we're go, Houston, we're go. And, well, so anyway, I found out later from the flight surgeon, my heartbeat was 144 a minute at that point. I was excited. We were on our way. John Young, the commander, he was in the left seat. I was in the right seat. He was in the left seat. Well, his heartbeat was 70. So, John had ridden on Apollo before, on Apollo 10. So he was used to this vibration. Anyway, we got into orbit, and we circled the Earth 1.5 times. And over Australia, we accelerated to 25,000 miles an hour, and we were on the way to the moon. We separated from the last stage of the rocket, the third stage. And Mattingly's now flying this thing. The windows are uncovered now so we can see out. And as he rolls it around and pitches it over to retrieve the lunar module, into my window floats the Earth out there. And it was awesome, breathtakingly beautiful. It was about 16,000, maybe 20,000 miles away. You could see the whole circle of the Earth. And we could see across the, and it was a jewel of beauty. It was the pure white of the snow and the clouds. You could see the Arctic Circle. You could see down across Canada, the United States, Mexico, Central America. You could see Cuba and Jamaica, and maybe a little bit of the Bahamas, but they were in a lot, little clouds. And there were three colors on the Earth. The white of the snow and the clouds, the brown of the land, and the crystal blue of the water. And that jewel was just suspended in the blackness of space. And everywhere else you looked, except for the moon, it was just black. It's always daylight in space. There's no night. The sun's always shining. So when the sun's shining in space, which is all the way to the moon, and just like down here when the sun's shining, you don't see any stars. You just look out into the velvety blackness of space. Now, you're in bright sunlight. It's not like being in the dark of a cave. But as you look out the window, you're in bright sunlight, but it's just this blackness of space out there. And it's a velvety black. It felt like you could reach out and touch it. And there's this jewel of Earth. Now, I wasn't a real student of the Bible back in those days, as I have been in the last 30 years. But as I began to read the Bible, I found a verse in Isaiah that says, God sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. Now, I didn't see God, but with these eyes, I saw the circle of the earth. And in the book of Job, there's a verse in like the 26th chapter, I think, maybe 27, right around in there. It says, when God made the earth, he suspended it upon nothing. And that's exactly what it looks like. Now I know you can walk down Fifth Avenue in New York City and turn into Rockefeller Center, and there's the earth on the back of some Greek god, Charles Atlas or somebody, you know. But he's not there, folks. It's held upon nothing. It's held there, suspended upon nothing. By the word of God says, by his word, it's suspended. So I began to trust the Bible as God's word, as God's handbook. But at the time, those thoughts didn't occur to me. If you think about it, those words were written 2,800 years ago in the scripture. Who told them it was a serpent? Who told them it was suspended upon nothing? Well, the Bible says God spoke the words into the heart of men who wrote them down under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and the words are true. And so I believe that in every situation, as God touches on our physical world, he speaks the truth. And there have only been 24 of us who have seen the circle of the earth with our eyes. There's not a person in here who hadn't seen a picture that we took of the circle of the earth. But we had the privilege, all American astronauts from 1968 until December 72, about a four-year time span, we had 24 of us got to see the circle of the earth. What a privilege that was as I look back. Now I look back and I can see the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the works of his hands. It's the most beautiful, orderly planet and system that we get to live in and enjoy. Perfect for life as God made it. But I was on the way to the moon, and we made it to the moon, and on the fourth day, John and I landed in this place called the Descartes Highlands, which is over in the central mountains of the moon. So as you look at the full moon, we were right in the middle of the full moon. It was an awesome valley. It was mostly gray in color, covered with dust, very, very fine, like powder, and which is actually pulverized rock. There is no atmosphere on the moon, never has been, so there's no organic material on the moon. It's all just rock that's been pulverized. And you can pick up this dust, you can pick up the soils, we call it, the regolith, and you can pick up the rocks that are scattered all over the moon, which was a big part of our, of course, three-day journey on the moon. We stayed for 72 hours. When we landed, the sun was low in the sky in the east, so it'd be early morning on the moon day. When we left, the sun was still in the east. A day from sunrise to sunset is 2 weeks. So we were only there for the early morning of the moon day, if you will. But the surface temperature climbed to about 230 degrees Fahrenheit on average while we were there. But our suits protected us from that. John and I had a wonderful time. We enjoyed ourselves as we explored the moon in our little moon buggy, which was made up here at Boeing, by the way, called the Lunar Rover. There are three of them that were carried to the moon. We left them up there. They were not designed to bring them back. They were designed to leave on the moon. And the television camera was operating, and so as we lifted off, you got to see our departure, which you didn't get to see on the first three lunar landings. So if you want an $8 billion car with a dead battery, there's three of them up on the moon. You can go get one if you like. It was a tremendous adventure. As I look out across the lunar surface, I can remember almost every step, man, in my mind, and looking up into this black sky of the moon. It was so bright on the lunar surface that you could look up, you didn't see the stars, but you could look way up, and over my head, 240,000 miles was the Earth. As I looked up, I saw a half Earth in the sky. As you looked up, you would have seen a half moon in the sky, and the moon was going towards the full phase. The Earth was going towards the new phase, so it was getting smaller and smaller. We didn't want to come back. We pleaded with them, let us stay another 2 hours, but get in, you guys, it's time to come home. So after almost 72 hours on the lunar surface, we departed, left our car and experiments and everything, and headed back home after a day in orbit around the moon. We splashed down in the Pacific, thanks to the United States Navy and the USS Ticonderoga. They were right on station, and we were right on target, and so they picked us up and took us over to the carrier via the helicopter and steamed us to Hawaii, and we flew back to Houston to a great welcome by our NASA friends. Apollo was a teamwork effort, and you couldn't get there on your own. It required everybody to do their job, from the mission controllers to the engineers to the janitors to the technicians. Everybody did their job. And so Apollo was a tremendous success. It was not a spiritual experience. I did not feel close to God. I didn't feel I needed God in my life other than what I had. As I told you, I went to church. I'd always been in church. My mom took me to church, and my twin brother, we went to church, and we respected God. I claimed to be a Christian, but looking back now in my heart, I know I was just somebody who went to a Christian church. And there's a verse in Isaiah that really described the way I was back then. And it's, these people come near to me with their lips and they honor me with their mouth, but their heart is far from God. And that's really the way I was. I was honoring God on Sundays, but the rest of the time I was in charge of my life. And I was doing a pretty good job, I thought. I was 36 years old. I got promoted to colonel with about, 15 years service and in the military. I was very successful as a military officer, an astronaut. and I had reached the top of my career. But I was successful on the outside, but on the inside, I wasn't satisfied. That drive that took me to the moon was still there. And the thought occurred to me in January 1973, Apollo's over, what are you going to do now for the rest of your life? Where's the challenge? What's he going to do? And so that was where I was, no peace, still striving. Success in my career, which was first in my life, by the way, my career, I don't know what's your God, but my idol was my career back in those days. And I was successful at it. It was, took first place in my life. But I wasn't doing very well as a husband and a father. My marriage was steaming towards divorce. Two young sons who barely knew their dad, who, by the way, was a military drill instructor dad. And a lot of you had five-year-olds, boys, in your families, and if you were like mine, five-year-olds don't respond to military discipline too well. And I had an explosive temper. Y'all got a lot of volcanoes around here. One of them blew up here back a while back, and that's the way I was. Bam, boom, I was off, just like the Mount St. Helens. And so you can imagine the tension in our family. But on outside, we were the all-American family. We were able to put on a big mask, if you will. Got so bad that by 1975, my wife was considering suicide. And we had everything. Why do you want to kill yourself? Man, we got nice cars, we got a house, a colonel, we're not millionaires, but we got a good salary. We're in society in Houston, got good health. You know, you got astronauts who've been on the moon. Engineer, you know, I could fix the washing machines, fix the cars, but I sure couldn't fix a wife that was on the verge of suicide. But God can. And they shared their faith and the power of Jesus Christ to change a life. And they had a love and a joy and a peace that we didn't have. And my wife looked at them and said, they people are different than we are. She tried everything to find her purpose in life. She thought marriage was going to be it. I was number one in her life. So I was her, she thought, Prince Charming. Well, it didn't take her long after the marriage to realize she hadn't married Prince Charming. And so the wheels came off of her dream of having this perfect marriage. And so things started unwinding over the years, and gradually it built up to despair, depression, and to considering suicide. But that weekend, she saw the reality of the love of God in the lives of these people, and she prayed, unbeknownst to me, she prayed, God, I don't know whether you were real, and I don't know whether you, Jesus, you're the Son of God, but these people say you are, and they have a love and a joy and a peace that I don't have, and I made a mess of my life. If you're real, I give you my life. If you're not real, I want to die. That was her prayer, which she told me about several months later. Well, over the next several months, I watched her change from sadness to joy as the reality of God indwelled her life. And the peace of God came, and the love of God. And about this time, I was leaving NASA. I'd take my eyes off the moon and put them on money. I left active duty, went into reserves, and became an entrepreneur, a businessman. And I was very successful at it. So for the next 2 years, I made a lot of money in business, finishing doing my military duty as a reservist, as a recruiter. I was the Air Force sort of poster boy in the early 80s for the big buildup of President Reagan in the military. They sent me all over the country. Look what the Air Force did for me. And you can do it for you too. The military is a good career, I was telling these young men and women. And I believe what I was saying. I believe the military is an honorable, just, wonderful career. I was proud to have served. But as I was in this business, I was watching my wife change. and she was loving me, and I was still the same guy. You see, that message of these people just went right over my head, or in one ear and out the other, because that weekend I wasn't thinking about the things of God. I was thinking about the $1.5 million I borrowed at the bank. And I was going to have people responsible for me and their jobs. They ended up having 42 people employed, 42 families responsible for our, and their jobs were in my hands. So it brought a lot of pressure, but I was successful. And my wife was just loving me. The boys were growing up. In 1978, I sold this business and said, well, maybe I'll get another business, because I really wasn't satisfied. And a friend of mine invited me to a Bible study at the tennis club. Now, that was a strange place for a Bible study, the local tennis club. But it turned out that the Holy Spirit showed up at the tennis club during this Bible study. Now, I resisted coming to this going to this Bible study. This doctor, our leading surgeon in our little town near in New Braunfels near San Antonio, invited me to a car box. Said, "Come on, go." I said, "Well, when is it?" "Well, it's 2 weeks." And he said, "How long does it last?" "Friday night, all day Saturday and Sunday." I said, "Boring. How do you study the Bible all weekend?" And I mean, that's my attitude. But he was so nice and such a good friend. I said, "Okay, we'll go." But it wasn't boring. I got there. I was challenged. It was called Walk Through the Bible, and it was sort of hit the highlights of from Genesis to Revelations, and it was all focused on Jesus. And I realized I had a free will. That God has given me a free will. Whether to believe what's written in the Bible, to receive it into my heart, or to reject it and go away. God says, it's up to you to decide. Is Jesus the Son of God? Is he the Messiah? Is he Lord of all? Did he die for your sins? Is that true? Or is it a big lie? Make up your mind, Charlie. Now, I've heard these scriptures ever since I was a little boy, but they were in my heart now. And I was convicted. I said, at the end of that weekend, I looked over at Dottie and we were in an automobile in the parking lot. And I said, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And I said, Lord, I give you my life. And I didn't, no bells and whistles went off, no booming voices from heaven, no angelic hosts started to sing like Alan. But I knew that I knew it was the truth. And inside, I just knew it. And peace started to come into my heart. I had this insatiable desire to read the Bible. And the more I read, the more convicted I became of my lifestyle. The Bible teaches in Hebrews that the Word of God is living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword, and it'll judge the attitudes of our hearts. A lot of people don't want to read the Bible because they get judged. And I wanted to. The Holy Spirit was very, I couldn't put it down. And the Holy Spirit was speaking to me about my family and about my marriage. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. The problem with your marriage is you, God was speaking to my heart. And I repented. I humbled myself. And I was a general, Air Force general. I was a fighter pilot, grim-jawed astronaut. There's not much room for humility in that job description. But God says, humble yourself before your family, before me. And I did, because I wanted to be the husband that God wanted me to be. And so I went to my wife and I said, forgive me. And she said, I'm all I have, but thank you. And we started walking together. And for over 30 years, man, we've been walking with Jesus. We had a lot of problems in that 30 years of walking with God. It hadn't been an easy bed of roses. There'd been potholes and bar ditches and the road to, on the road to life. But not one promise of God has failed us. And we don't think about divorce anymore. We're in love with God. We're in love with each other. We counsel one another. We seek each other's advice. And God has healed that marriage. And so we're walking together. The Lord delivered me from that explosive temper, especially with my children. And he showed me I better watch what I say, because we have the power of life and death in our tongues. That's a little verse out of Proverbs. And God spoke to my heart again about my kids. Said, you cursed your own children. I don't mean profanity. I mean, boy, you're stupid. That's dumb. And they were becoming exactly what I spoke. Because our words have power as fathers and grandfathers in the lives of our children. And so I went to the young Thomas, 9. No, he was 11. And I said, I was in tears. I said, Tom, forgive me. He's looked up and said, that's okay, Dad. And I began to bless him, encourage him, like the scripture says. And I watched him blossom like flowers in the springtime. Y'all got a beautiful spring here in this part of the U.S., God's country. I've been up here a couple of times in springtime. Never seen such color. Beautiful. Even in the rain, it's beautiful. And so we were on our way as a family. They gave their lives to Jesus. And so they began to pray as they went on into school. And I watched God answer their prayers and lead them into their careers. And one, Tom, is a fighter pilot in the Texas Air Guard. And when he decided he wanted to be a military pilot, I said, you be the best you can be for the glory of God. And I think he is. He's part-time in there with the Guard. He's flying for Delta Airlines, the big international stuff. My little boy flying an airplane 15 hours with 300 people back there. It's hard to believe. He's a lieutenant colonel. I can't even believe I got a lieutenant colonel. I'm that old. I am. And he's blessed me with 3 children. His older brother's a businessman. And he said, he wants to be the best he can. They've got 6 children. And so we've been blessed. I'm blessing my grandchildren. So I'm trying to say that God changes us on the inside. And I am under God now. There really is a God. And I do submit my life to God now. And that pledge, it means something to me now. I really am under God. I try to seek God's counsel, seek His direction, seek His will for my life. And I pray for our nation. Our nation is a nation under God. And we, as believers, should pray, not only on prayer breakfasts, but every day for the leadership and the guidance that we need in our nation. God would be God of all in our communities. There is power in prayer. I'll make a cute story. This came out of the Air War College back during the Vietnam days. This was a true story written by this lieutenant colonel, and this had happened to him in Vietnam. He was an F-4 pilot, and a SAM missile blew off the back of his airplane, lost control, and he's spinning out of control, and he's eject. Well, the backseater pulled a ring, and out he went. But in the F-4, there's a big bar over the center of the cockpit, and if the cockpit doesn't go, you don't go. And the cockpit wouldn't go. The canopy wouldn't go. And so he's trapped. And he's out of control, 600 knots. And all of a sudden he said, what came to his mind was something his mama told him as a little boy. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. He said, I instantly became a whosoever. And he said, Jesus, help me. Save me. The canopy went off and he was out of the airplane. And he was severely injured, as you can imagine, 600 knots when he hit that airstream. But he gave glory to God. And so there are many stories like that in my life. I pray for our nation. We are really under God. As I began to pray and seek God's counsel, I began to discover, as I read many books on the history of our nation, that our forefathers conceived a nation that embraced freedom of religion, not freedom from religion in our national life. They set it in was separate from any church denomination, but not separate from God. That was not their intent. They were not. There was not going to be the Church of the United States of America, in other words. We were free to worship in any church we wanted to. So our nation was, the first ones to come over were the Pilgrims, one of the first, and the Mayflower Compact starts with this preamble. We whose names are underwritten, having undertaken this voyage for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith and in honor of king and country, do solemnly and mutually in the presence of God covenant ourselves to body together in a civil body politic. That was the purpose of the Mayflower voyage and the Pilgrims coming to America to establish our nation. So that was, I look at it as our foundation. And for the next 150 years, our forefathers trusted God. We weren't perfect as a nation, but we sought God's direction. They penned the Declaration of Independence. All men are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. The rallying cry of the Revolutionary War was no king but King Jesus. You don't see that in a history book today in our schools, but it was the truth. Go read Peter Marshall's book, The Light and the Glory. And all of these, of the godly men and women that served us. Patrick Henry, I knew Patrick Henry as a Virginian who said, give me liberty or give me death. But he also said, it cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists but by Christians. Not on religion but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. For this very reason, people of other faiths have been afforded asylum, prosperity, and freedom of worship here. And that's true for every major religion in this world. They're free to worship in our country. But our country, as a nation, was founded on the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I could go on and on and on with some of the quotes from our forefathers. It goes on down into this day, though. You might be surprised, as I was, to know that church services were held in the House of Representatives chambers until after the Civil War. One of the attenders was Thomas Jefferson, who wrote the letter that says to build a wall of separation between church and state, yet this man's going to church in the House. How could he have meant to separate our life from the church or religion? Congress commissioned the first American Bible translation. Communion services were held in the Supreme Court building and in the Treasury. James Madison said, we have staked the future of all of our political institutions upon the capacity of each and all of us to govern ourselves according to the Ten Commandments of God. Our forefathers knew God. They served God. They acknowledged God. And I believe we should do the same. President Reagan said, if we ever forget we are a nation under God, we will be a nation gone under. Amen. We are the nation. You and me. Not the buildings. It's the people. We pledge. Not the buildings. We do. So I'm going to challenge you today. I'm going to throw out a challenge. Just like Joshua threw out a challenge to the children of Israel. You got them into the promised land. Called them all together. And said, choose this day whom you shall serve. He was a big general, politician. But God had picked him to go take the promised land. So they were over there, and they were fighting, driving out the pagans under God's direction. And he challenged them, choose this day whom we, you shall serve. As for me and for my house, we will serve the Lord. So I challenge you, whom will you serve? Will you serve the Lord or some pop philosophy that might be in vogue today? As for me and for my house, we will serve the Lord. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings upon our great nation. We thank you for the opportunity, as we've already prayed, Lord, for the privilege of being here to worship you, to give you honor. Lord, you know the hearts of every person in here. I don't, but you do. Lord, I believe by your Spirit you're speaking to our hearts now. People are making decisions. So if you're here and God's speaking to your heart to serve me, to serve me, to serve him, make that choice. Open your heart to the Lord Jesus. Say, Lord, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I want to follow you. I want to be a person under God, seeking your will, seeking your wisdom, following your word. And may your word, Lord, be a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. So, Lord, we commit this city to you. We commit this 23rd prayer breakfast to you, Lord. Thank you for the faithfulness of the men and women who made it possible. Thank you for filling this room. Father, I know there's not one person in here that's here by accident. You call us all together. So we praise you and we thank you. And God, we ask you that you would bless us and bless America. In Jesus' name. God bless you. Thank you very much. Amen.